Today's painting is using a reference photo from unsplash.com. I'll be cropping it following the golden ratio. I have my image in Photoshop. I'm going to use guides to divide it into quarters equally. Welcome to my channel, Shelley J. Cox. Come along with me on my art journey. So let's analyze the colors in our reference material so we have a good idea of the colors that we need to make for our paint palette. I'm going to start first by finding the light values, then we'll find the mid values, and finally we'll look for the dark values. If I click on an area and I feel like I already have that color on my palette, I'll just skip putting it on there and go to another area. I'm always amazed at what color the highlights in the eyes and the whites of the eyes end up being. Once I have all the colors on the palette side there, I like to turn it into a black and white view so that I can make sure all of my colors are grouped together properly. So you have the lights, the mids, and then the darks. Today's painting, I'll be using a 12 by 12 canvas that I coated in black gesso. I've made some white chalk marks just to mark out the grid. And I'm looking to see that I have the exact size of the head on the computer screen that I will want to have on my canvas, which ended up being a 56% zoom for that. All right, next I'm going to mix up my palette. You can see here the colors that I've used. I'll also list that in the description. I'm using a pretty limited palette. I've got the primary colors there, the yellow, the red, the blue. I've added the transparent oxide brown and the Van Dyke brown just to have a little variety. And this way the colors won't be too saturated. I can use the browns to help mute them easily. Here you can see how I have everything set up and I'm ready to paint. The only preliminary marks on the canvas are the grid you see here. And I did mark a little tick mark at the top where the head will stop and at the bottom where the chin goes. This will keep me in line and keep me from, I tend to make my features too small, and this way I'll be sure to have them sized correctly. And I'm going to also be using my proportion tool to double check. So I apologize for the flickering light. I think it has a little bit to do with painting on this black canvas, which was an experiment for me. I've only painted on a black canvas one other time, and that was a portrait of my dog Kona. So this was a reminder that it's definitely not my first choice painting on black. I think what I've learned now is that my favorite way to start is on a toned canvas. Second to that would be just a white canvas, but I think black canvas is my least favorite. One of the reasons it's my least favorite is you have to paint really thick in the lighter areas, which is something that I should do anyway, but it's definitely something you have to think about while you're painting. And in the areas of the shadow, I like to be a little more transparent and usually let an underpainting show through there. But with this situation, you have to judge how much of the black you want to let show through in the shadow areas, because it can make your shadows too dark if you're not careful there. If you like these type of videos, give me a thumbs up, and then be sure to subscribe and come along with me on my art journey. So if you're new to the channel and you're not familiar with selective start, that's kind of the, well, that's the method that I am using here. So you lay down a paintbrush mark to start, and each successive paintbrush stroke after that is going to touch the one before. So you're just building out from that initial brush stroke, and you're touching and moving to the next brush stroke. And ideally you want to completely finish one feature or area that you're working on before you move on to the next. But I almost always have to go back into, say, that first eye that I started with. It's definitely going to get some touches and a little edits along the way as I continue down and across the face. I'll go back over the features once I have them all down again. So I found this really great reference photo on unsplash.com. It's another free website. You just give credit to the photographers. It's like pexels.com. So I use those two a lot, especially now it's hard to take your own photos. Models are difficult to book with this 2020 pandemic thing going on. So I've been leaning hard on the free picture sites. Often when I find a picture, it's not perfectly situated the way I want it. So like you saw here, I cropped it, and then in Photoshop I did end up, I think I increased the contrast and darkened it a little bit. But there are some great options in these sites if you know what to look for in a good painting portrait reference. So this is a regular cotton duct canvas that's, it was just gesso primed when I got it, and I added my own two layers of the black gesso, sanded it, and it got pretty smooth. I definitely prefer to paint on more smooth surfaces. I'm loving the cradled pine that's gesso coated, and then usually I'll add a layer of oil primer to that white and sand it and then paint on that. That's a really great surface. But I'm thinking about trying to paint on a mirror. I don't know how archival it'll be, but I'm gonna look into it and maybe we'll do a video on that, see what it's like to paint on a mirror. Here's a close-up look of the brush strokes. I really want them to stay fresh and look like they were just laid down. I want each brush stroke, especially towards the top layers, to kind of be the star of the painting. And when you put all those amazing brush strokes together, you get a really cool, beautiful, expressive portrait. So thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one. And here towards the end of the video, you'll get the view of the final painting coming up.